I want to welcome everyone and thank you for spending your beautiful Saturday with us. I think it's very important that we have this meeting. You know that Valero will be having a presentation on their DEIR on earlier than priorly scheduled on Monday. And the planning, I think it begins at 5:30 at the Ironworkers, 5 o'clock at the Ironworkers Hall for about an hour and a half. And then the Planning Commission is going to be hosting also a DEIR workshop to benefit their understanding as well of the process. Our points today will be made largely about CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act. And Roger Lynn of Communities for a Better Environment will be, who is their attorney, will be presenting briefly, as we say on the agenda, in a nutshell, what CEQA is. We're here to examine the document, the draft EIR, and to look at the project through its lens. We're not here to talk about the project per se, because right now we're in a 45-day review period in which we look at the project through the lens of what the consultants have got to say and what the city has to consider through the CEQA process. What we want to do is help you develop your powers of inquiry and develop confidence in exercising those powers so that you can actually investigate this document to see what you think of it, what you find in it, what you find missing in it, what you find maybe a little squishy or something that is not quite fully described. And this is something you can get used to as you read this document. The law of CEQA law was adopted in 1970, and just so you have courage, I want to let you know that a lot of controversy is arisen by a document such as this that is very complex about a refinery project. There is usually controversy between those who are considered experts. Some of us who have had a long experience looking at EIRs are considered local experts. Then they have the experts who are from the regulatory agencies like the Air District or the Water District. And then our city is allegedly also an expert. But the main thing here is that we all will know that there will be controversy and it could go to court. So anything that you have to say has to be considered and could end up as part of a legal record. So in that sense, this is to the benefit of the whole process, not just in the 45-day review period. So take confidence from that. We are here to invite anyone of any opinion to consider the document. Whether Valero has representatives here, I don't know, but they are welcome here. Other businesses, people who are on the fence about this project, don't know what quite to think yet, that's all fine. We, as Benicians for a Safe and Healthy Community, a nonprofit, it's not a nonprofit, it's just a grassroots group organized in about January to fully address this project and its impacts for the community and to promote the things we care about most, sustainability and our climate action plan and our general plan. So we invite you to think in terms of our position. We are opposed to the project, as we have stated many times, and maybe you've attended our forums. But the main thing is for you to think independently, come to your own conclusions. What we have before us is an arduous task, but your voice and your comments really do count. We must tell the city what we think. And if we all participate in this, it's going to make a job for the consultants because they have to respond to our comments on everything that we submit. So with that, I'd like to turn this over to Roger.
I'm Roger Lynn. I'm an attorney with Communities for a Better Environment. Thank you, everyone, for coming out today. So I just want to just ask a question, first of all, just sort of like lay the general theme of this. Who pays for the consultant? Does anyone hatch a guess?
Well,
the
applicant.
Okay, here a different.
The applicant does.
What do you think the average price tag on your everyday generic 2,000, 3,000 page EIR is?
$2 million.
See, that's a great guess. Yeah, about $2 million. It depends on like the detail. But this one probably, I don't know, but I'm guessing approximately about $2 million as well. The Phillips Rodeo one, $2 million. So given that, I'm not going to say they are lying, but there's, if you're spending that much money for a consultant to describe your project to, in order to get your permits, it kind of just lays a general theme of things. And the second thing I want to start with as well is that CEQA asks questions. It requires the agencies to all ask questions. And in the scheme of all of these crude by rail projects, like traditionally, and this is the bad news, CEQA won't kill a project. It won't stop a project by itself. But the flip side of that is in the context of all of these crude by rail projects, we've seen with Westpac, people started asking, is this going to bring in tar sands? Who knows what's happening with the Westpac project now? It's been delayed indefinitely. It may come back, who knows? And with the Phillips 66 one as well, the Air District had problems with the EIR's analysis, and that one is just delayed and delayed and delayed. And in this field, delay could be our best friend, given that the federal government is also coming up with new regulations every day. The refineries are racing through to get their projects through before these new regulations come into effect. So at the end of the day, like, yes, CEQA does not have the teeth that we want it to, but the power of delay is pretty, don't underestimate it. So I know we're kind of trying to zoom through, so. But in a nutshell, CEQA law came into effect in 1970, primarily as a means to require public agency decision makers to consider environmental implications. So ask the right questions. So when you think about what comments you want to make, what you want to submit to the city to consider, think about how do you get the city to ask the right questions. Next. So, and I always think of law as sort of like a vocabulary test. So it's just a whole bunch of terms for things that we all understand and know. So basically, the EIR Environmental Impact Report, who is the lead agency in this?
The city.
The city is the lead agency. They pay for the, they hire consultants. As we just discussed, the project, whoever's pitching the project pays for the consultants. And basically, the lead agency has to consider two things. First, all significant environmental impacts of the project. And second, whether there are feasible alternatives or mitigation measures to make those impacts not significant. Two more vocabulary things, public comment and participation. That is one of the best things about CEQA, in that with an environmental impact report, every time an environmental impact report is issued, there has to be a public comment period. So that is what's happening right now. And then, is there a hearing date set?
July 10th.
And then that'll be an opportunity to participate as well and tell all the council members or planning commissioners exactly what you think there. And ultimately, what the planning commissioners are going to do, if they approve the EIR, if they say it's okay, that is certification. And that is the end. The EIR is certified. There will be a conditional use permit with conditions in there. And the project can go ahead. Next. Okay, next again, sorry. And as I said before, this is the main question that everyone should be considering. How does this project affect my health? Whether it's air emissions, pollution, or public safety hazards. Or also the same hazards that are going to affect the workers at the refinery as well. So the whole time, just when you look at the EIR, just think, how are all these project components going to affect my health? EIR has to identify the significant impacts and whether there are feasible alternatives and mitigation measures. So those are exactly what it sounds like. Is there an alternative? So crude by rail. Is there an alternative way to transport the crude? Is there an alternative way to get the crude? And mitigation measures. If they finally do have to transport it this way, is there a way to like make it like less bad, like with safer rail cars, like stuff like that? And ultimately, think of those worst case scenario, if this project does go through, as the conditions, the mitigation measures to be the conditions that would go into the conditional use permit. Because at the end of the day, the EIR forms the building block for a conditional use permit that the refinery has to get in order to run its project. Next. And now we're going to go to some of the common mistakes and things to look out for in an EIR. Does anyone want to have a crack at giving me an example of what deferred mitigation is? It's pretty obvious from that, but so reliance on tentative plans for future mitigation after certification.
Air quality monitoring.
Yes, you could be like, the EIR could say, and I'm not saying this one does, but it could say something like, we will install the best monitoring technology in the future. We have no idea what it is or when we'll get it, but we'll do it. So just look out for things. Another one we've seen with, that I've seen at least with other Crude by Rail Project EIRs is the deferring of a process hazard analysis. So there has to be interagency, like they have to talk to the Contra Costa County Hazardous Materials Department, and they have to make a plan like
Solano County.
I'm sorry, too many counties. There are a lot of Crude by Rail projects going on right now, you cannot defer like your what if like this goes wrong. Like you have to have a prevention plan in place, or the EIR has to at least analyze the effectiveness or non-effectiveness of a prevention plan. Next, please. And then we go back to alternatives. A lot of EIRs just don't even go there. Some EIRs say, okay, there's this alternative, but it's not really feasible. But then you look at how much did they look at that alternative, you know, and is their conclusion that it's not feasible? Like say there's an alternative that involves renewables. I'm sure there is. Is the EIR's reasoning for that one being feasible or not? Is that a conclusory statement? I don't know. I haven't seen this one, but something to think about. Next one. Going back to a significant effect on the environment. This is the definition of it, and there is no real definition of it. As you see, it's a substantial or potentially substantial adverse change in the environment. I mean, depending on who you are, it's a gray area, you know, and that's why the public participation elements of CEQA are so important. For example, noise during the construction period. Like, don't only think about this, the EIR, or EIRs in general, don't even only think about them as like the operation of the project, but the construction of the project as well, or whether, how long that'll take, or, and you all, being the community, are the ears and eyes on the ground that can inform the decision makers. So, don't let the term significant effect, you know, it is all, at the end of the day, you are the community. If it's a significant effect to you, it's a significant effect. And definitely let the decision makers know that. Next, please. And these are two other common mistakes. Project description, and this is the definition of a project description. It has to allow for an intelligent evaluation of the potential environmental effects of an activity. The thing I think about this one is CBE's case against the city of Richmond about the Chevron refinery, about the crude quality, the switch in crude quality there. The switch in crude quality obviously has greater air emission impacts. Switch in crude quality also has more public safety impacts because stuff like tar sands, Bakken is more volatile than like, the non-volatile ones. The sweet line ones, yeah. So think about the project description. That is generally the main hook in any EIR comment. It's like, does the EIR really tell you exactly everything you need to know to like decide whether this is a good or a bad project? If they're still asking questions, look at the other comments of other agencies, because they have to provide comments too. If other agencies like the Air District still ask questions and don't know exactly what's going on with the project, then it doesn't have an accurate project description. Piecemealing, is it reasonably foreseeable that a piece of a certain project depends on another piece of a different project? So with the Phillips refinery has one half of it in Rodeo. The other half of it is in the Central Coast in Santa Maria. Both of them together are called the San Francisco refinery. So for us, it was very easy to identify that they couldn't do their crude by rail project without making changes at both pieces of the San Francisco refinery. So with this EIR, you could also think about what is the other piece? There has to be an end point to the crude by rail. It doesn't just start and then mysteriously go in random places. You know, so think, is there another part of this project that has to be there in order for this project to happen? And if there is, and that one's not described in the EIR, the project is piecemealed. So, next one. Cumulative impacts, the environmental justice one. That one is a common mistake. Where EIRs may not look at exactly other projects in the area. So with the Phillips EIR, what we noticed, the Phillips crude by rail EIRs, what we noticed is that it didn't describe the other crude by rail projects in the area that were happening. Something to think about with this one too. And also when you think about future projects, this one is more for the hot one for the how far emissions go, greenhouse gases. How far do you have to measure how much greenhouse gases affect the community? Do you end at the gates of the refinery? Or do you end at the city boundary, the state's boundary, the country, the world? So it's all very subjective, but check out what the EIR says about that. Check out what you think, how far the analysis should go. I think a safe bet would be to say that it's the California Environmental Quality Act CEQA, so the boundary should at least be California. And last one, baseline. Does anyone want to take a crack at what baseline is for pollutants? Yes. Yes, exactly. So he said how things were before. So basically, what is the kind of like status quo? What is it right now? How will this project change emissions above or below what it is right now? That's the baseline. A lot of EIRs mess with their baseline. Do they want does a refinery generally want its baseline to be higher or lower?
Higher.
Right. So there may be some inflation of the baseline going on. We've definitely seen that in a lot of EIRs. And that's always a fight. And that's my last pitch as well for the fact that this isn't just, even though CEQA is a very powerful tool legally, it really depends on like the community folks as well, like telling the decision makers exactly what's going on, and also the science behind everything. And NRDC is helping a lot with this project, and they have a great science team. So I think everyone in here is in good shape. Natural Resources Defense Council. So, next one. Oh, already mentioned this one. Obviously, the EIR has to disclose hazards and response plans and not just say, we'll do the response plans in the future. The response plans have to be in the EIR. Otherwise, it is called?
Deferred
mitigation. Right. Next. And we're done. But remember, the overarching question, how does this project affect my health? Think about all those ways that the general pitfalls that EIRs have. But yeah, happy to answer any questions. The Planning Commission is the body that's voting on the whether to certify the EIR or not first. If whoever doesn't like the decision of the Planning Commission decides to appeal it, it then goes to the City Council. If whoever doesn't like the decision of the City Council, then they can appeal it and it goes to California Superior Court.
So. If the Planning Commission says no, does it stop there?
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily. If the Planning Commission says we do not want to certify the EIR, then it is up to the project proponent, whether the project proponent wants to pitch for the EIR being recirculated to correct all of the deficiencies in it. So when an EIR is recirculated, it opens up the public comment period again. We're in the public comment period right now, and it's 45 days?
Correct.
So far it's 45 days. If it's recirculated, they may say, okay, 30 days and we'll fix this part of it, this part of it, this part of it, and you have 30 days to comment again on the parts that we fixed. If the project proponent decides that that's the route, project proponents in the past have just pulled projects too. So
I'm going to comment on that one of the alternatives that is contained in an EIR is no alternative.
But if you did want to stop any expansion, then the CEQA route is a very viable route given the power of delay. And the Planning Commission has, basically, the Planning Commission. The EIR is just part of the process to make a building block for the Planning Commission to issue, if it decides to approve a project, a conditional use permit. The conditions come from the EIR process, where it's like folks identify like all of the risks that are associated with the project, and the conditions are meant to address those. So they have the power to, Planning Commissions have power to do any condition they need to, as long as it has some relationship to public safety.
Paper from the city of Benicia, because I live in the relocation zone less than a half mile from Valero. And I'm amazed that the entire city didn't get this. However, it does say here, summary of significant impacts on the environment. The DEIR concluded that there would be a significant and unavoidable impact associated with air quality. So my question is, what does that mean exactly? Is that carcinogenic air quality? What air quality? And how can the Planning Commission possibly go ahead when the city is already announcing that?
Okay, so usually the significant effect is found, for CEQA at least, it's very robotic. Before, when I said significant effect, when you talk to the decision makers, it's very subjective. You can let them know what would be a significant effect to you. For the EIR's purposes, at least, it's extremely robotic. And for air emissions, usually what they look at is what the air district says is a threshold of significance. If there's X amounts of particulate matter, it's pollutant by pollutant specific as well. So it has to say there will be a significant effect of NOx or SOx or particulate matter, or it has to specify which one it is. And it's so robotic in that if there's any emissions over that threshold, then it's basically just found significant. The whole purpose of CEQA is to mitigate every impact to less than significance. It's up to the commissioners and the council members where they want something that just can't be possibly mitigated to below significance go through, or whether they believe that and whether they think that they still can mitigate it.
The unavoidable impact is a cumulative impact that would occur by if you were measuring the diesel emissions from the locomotives leaving Benicia and going out to through the county and back to Roseville, and who knows how, I think they count it to Roseville. So it's impacts that are considered indirect impacts that are going to be impacting other communities up rail. You catch that? So, and that's not to say there won't be considerably cumulative air impacts here, because we're adding a new ingredient here, which is two different kinds of crude that are going to be processed here. Likely tar sands, because it's heavy and sour, and that's what this refinery has been tuned up to do over the last 10 years. And possibly Bakken. I have heard Valero speak early on last year that Bakken would be considered as one of their import possibilities. And that was said at their presentation a few months back at the Ironworkers, or month back at the Ironworkers Hall. So at least casually or informally, they don't put it in writing, but we have heard those things. And so that has an impact on emissions, whether that DER says so or not. We can make our own conclusions. And let me just add that between CBE, Communities for a Better Environment, and also Natural Resources Defense Council, which has just contracted Phyllis Fox, a refinery expert, who also weighed in heavily on the first EIR of Valero's, which was for the Valero Improvement Project that got started in 2003 and has been going on ever since till about 2014, they're going to be finished with their hydrogen plant, which, by the way, is a requirement for processing tar sands. That you need more hydrogen atoms clinging to carbon, the carbon chain, in order to make that stuff come out as a refined product. So this, and by the way, the VIP EIR was done by the same consultants who are doing this latest CBR, Environmental Impact Report. And one thing that, just one more piece of information. When we talk about CEQA documents, this is an example of an error, a large error, that Valero made back in 2000. This is prepared June 2008. It's called an addendum to the VIP EIR. And in fact, we knew that it should have been a supplemental EIR, considering the numbers of changes and upgrades they were making, some very good ones. However, it should have been a document circulated to the public as a supplemental EIR. They wanted to get busy with construction. That's their job, right? These guys are business people who want to get going with construction. Well, this document was insufficient. We could have gone to court. And the Good Neighbor Steering Committee challenged this document's use. And in fact, that's how the settlement agreement was arrived at. Now, that's because we couldn't afford to go to court. We didn't have attorneys from Natural Resources Defense Council at that time helping us. So we did the best we could for the community and to alert Valero that we're paying attention. So we read this document, commented on it, and it earned us that settlement agreement that everybody still talks about and wonders what the heck was that all about. But now we have the same company, ESA, reviewing and doing this document. So you see how it goes.
NEPA is basically the federal version of CEQA. CEQA is California Environmental Quality Act, NEPA, National Environmental Protection Act. So it's basically the national equivalent. That's an excellent question. And I hope that folks at the Natural Resource Defense Council and back at CBE are going to explore it. Thank you. For me, any other venue, any other forum to get your folks' voice out there, I think, is very, very important, especially right now when the federal government's looking at this issue. So, in the back again, the lead agency does. They have discretion to say 30, 45, or 60 in very, very extraordinary circumstances. No one really knows what that means. 90 days.
What's the minimum?
30. Endangered species route. When I said CEQA lacks teeth, the one environmental statute that doesn't lack teeth is the Endangered Species Act. The Endangered Species Act can flat out kill a project. If a project is going to kill our fun little critter or vegetation, the endangered species, then the Endangered Species Act actually prevents that project from ever happening.
24/7, meaning a 24-hour day cycle, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, 100 cars coming in, split between two trains, and as the project describes, and 100 cars going out every day. That's 200 cars. If you don't have time to read anything else in the next week to get yourself sort of acclimated, read the executive summary. And the executive summary is pretty squishy, in my view. That's what I call it. And they give alternatives to the project. One is, of course, the no project alternative. One is limiting the project to one 50-car train a day. But guess what? They eliminate that. The consultants say, well, we can't really do alternative one because, and I'm going to read this to you because this goes to your points, many points made already. Union Pacific Railroad has taken the position that any limitation on the volume of product shipped or the frequency, route, or configuration of such shipments is clearly preempted under federal law. Union Pacific has summarized its position in a statement sent forth in Appendix L. Thus, alternative one may be legally infeasible by federal exemption. Now, that is a preemption. So you can't, you know, UP's trying to make money. They don't want Valero to limit the amount of product they bring in every day. You know, so we're up against people, companies that want to make a lot of money, for one thing. But Davis, City of Davis, voted to commit staff time and their city attorney to reviewing the Valero project, EIR. That's never happened in Benicia, that we have outside cities looking in. That's how important. So make sure you participate in this. The Benicia Independent, everybody should know about Roger Straw, editor, who has created for us the most incredible source and resource for all of us. On every article that's been written across the country and locally, regionally, and with all the comments that have ever been sent in, Roger has done an extraordinary job for us, and the BenicianIndependent.com is where you want to go.
The thing about a discussion like this is it's overwhelming because of the size of it and what we have to do in a matter of a few days. So I'll introduce myself first. My name is Jim Lambden. You see me in the program as an attorney, which is true. I've been a lawyer for about 40 years. SEEK was started when I started as a lawyer. I'll also come clean that I was a judge in Alameda County, and for most of my career, I was an appellate justice. And I did nothing but, on bad days, read these things. That doesn't mean I'm an expert. I'm not here as an authority. I'm here as a citizen of Benicia, because I've lived here a long time, and I'm alarmed about this project and its implications as well. So what I'd like to do is not answer the kind of questions that Roger was asking. He's a real lawyer. I'm presently a professional mediator. I don't practice law. But I can answer some of your questions, but that's not really what I want to do about that. What I want to do is focus you on the fact that this is a process issue. It's also a political issue. It's also an environmental issue. It's a lot of things. But CEQA itself is first and foremost process. And as you've heard from the discussion earlier, much of what we're doing here today is creating a record. I want to underline that. Does it sound like court creating a record? It is court, because the city council in this process, again, I'm not going to give you the whole civil procedure course, is acting in a quasi-judicial function. It is making essentially a decision based on facts about a reasonable outcome. Among judges, we like to say when a statute has the word reasonable in it, that means you go to court. Because basically people disagree about reasonable. So when we approach the city council, let me step back a minute. When you approach the planning commission in a few days, we're going to be trying to get them to do something. They're not sitting as a judge. They're going to basically advise the council. The council is the one that's going to make the first decision in this case based on the EIR. Their job is to create an EIR, a draft EIR. It starts as a draft so that it can be complete. It has to be honest and fully disclose everything that is required. It then has to have enough time, and this is the process part, for people to comment. And then it has to result in a reasoned decision. The decision can, in the end, be, even if, one of the questions I heard earlier was, there's a significant environmental impact. Shouldn't that be the end of the story? It isn't the end of the story. They can still approve it. And in the end, this is designed really for the purpose that's most exciting about this meeting here today. It's designed to have democratic, grassroots comments paid attention to. These days, a lot of people feel like very uncomfortable that government is not listening to them, they're not paying attention to them. This is a statute that says the government has to pay attention to you. It says that not only your oral comments at the meeting will be part of the record, but your written comments will be part of the record, and they have to be responded to. So you've got the law you've always dreamed of. Around the world, people dream of that. That doesn't mean it answers the question, because you have to do it in the form that is required. For example, if your comment is, I'm against global warming, they don't have to respond to that, really. Sort of general comments that I'm against the project. They don't really have to respond to that either. But if you ask them a really thorny question about the equation that's under Section 4 here that says that 111 years is how often you can expect a derailment around here. Take a look at that. I mean, if you're a mathematician, you could help us by saying there's a problem with that equation. But you don't have to be a mathematician. All of us chuckled over that. That doesn't sound right. Really? 111 years? I mean, there were seven of them or six of them in the last 7 months. So that, yeah. 6 months, whatever. There's a bunch of them in the last year. That just doesn't sound right. So something in this report that doesn't sound right is where we want to focus our attention. Many people in this room, just from the questions I heard earlier today, have expertise in these areas and are able to ask them difficult questions. Because what we're trying to do is ask difficult questions on the record, questions that they must respond to. And the level of response that you get to the question in the final EIR is going to depend on how sophisticated your question was. So I've been asked to facilitate today so that we can break into these groups, and we're going to do that. A lot of you came here with specific concerns. A lot of you came with friends. A lot of you know people. So if we break this project up, this is the problem, the size of it and the time that we have. If we break it down into chunks and things that you're interested in, you will be able to ask the questions that can cause them some serious problems in terms of approving this project. And we can nudge the whole process in the right direction. However, generally speaking, CEQA doesn't look at economic impacts. It looks at it indirectly. And there is case law that says that they don't look at property values either. There are other ways to get to it, though. Aesthetics. If you live in Water's End, you're looking right down on the thing that's going to blow up. And it can be, I think, implied, and it is implied in a lot of cases I've seen, that the city is affected in its overall aesthetic. You can't just come out and say property values. That generally hasn't been listened to, because this is all about economics. It's the same for Valero as well. Yeah, unaware, though, that there's anything in there about, in the risk section, about who bears the risk of a dangerous amount. Some of you have asked, how do I write this letter? Write it out on the back of a paper bag and we'll help you. It doesn't matter, you know, just get that comment down and make it as insightful and analytical as you can, and let the steering committee know, and we'll help you put it in the form, and we'll give you the addresses and everything else. So don't worry about format. Just stay involved. That's what's really important for us. Examples of what leads to litigation that causes a CEQA to be disapproved or a project to be stopped. And I should add that it's rarely stopped at this stage. It's usually stopped in litigation. And that's why the record is so important. And it can be stopped very early with litigation as well. So that doesn't mean we're talking about a 10-year fight in court with a lot of money spent. Preliminary injunctions are not uncommon in this area, where they just say don't do it. Frequent reasons for litigation. The information in the report is incomplete. Doesn't say enough. Or it's vague. The one example I know is in here, and I haven't studied it, but it says that the emergency response to a spill or derailment will be via cooperation with local authorities. That doesn't sound like a plan to me. That's not a plan. And what Roger Lynn was saying earlier about deference of plans is important in this, because they may well say, well, we're working with them and we're going to buy some more equipment. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that they can say they're going to do in the future, but watch for that. Because if it's not in here now, we need to call them on it and see what the next answer is, and maybe the next one's no good either, and then we run out the process. We're running out the clock. Know what it's got in there about traffic? Does it have both commute, non-commute? Does it look at every off-ramp, every on-ramp? Does it do what's necessary to actually answer the question about traffic? Because this is a huge train. You know, it's over a mile long, 100 cars, isn't it? I mean, 50 cars.
4,000 feet.
Yeah.
50 cars.
Yeah, nearly a mile long.
Traffic.
Yeah.
These are the EIR topics are listed.
On page ES8. That's the executive summary, page 8. You don't all have to go there right away.
Can I say one thing?
Yeah, go right ahead. Good.
It's typical, Roger Lynn didn't go over this, but it's typical based on scoping comments that were received earlier in the year that they choose what topics legally will be a part of this document. Let me just rattle them off, because in your groups you can talk about these areas: air quality, biological resources, cultural resources, think historic districts and how close they are to train tracks, energy conservation, geology and soils, which I've checked it out, includes some discussion of seismicity, think of the tracks, greenhouse gas emissions, hazardous and hazardous materials, hydrology and water quality, land use and planning, noise, transportation and traffic. Now that sounds pretty comprehensive. You'll have to read into these sections. Since we all have limited time, pick the subject area or areas that most preoccupy you or worry you. There is also one that sometimes in a development EIR, it's called urban blight. And that's the way you get out the economic hit to a city if you had a major catastrophe. Nowhere in this document, as far as I know, are there credible worst-case scenarios. They must talk about the potential for specific kinds of emergencies and catastrophes that have happened 6 times in the last year. And if we do not have them identifying specific things that their emergency plans address, then it's inadequate. It's a fatal flaw.
I said the major way that one of these gets into court is something gets left out. So you're looking for what's missing in here quite often. You mentioned cultural stuff. I mean, water is in here. We're in a drought. The refinery uses a lot of water, I'm sure, and they use, I'm sure, a lot of gray water. But look at that. I don't know if we have a water expert in here, but exactly whether or not that's a reasonable plan is beyond my expertise with reference to the amount of water that's used and future use. As I mentioned earlier, though, the kind of things that aren't usually included, which would be excluded, but unless you can come up with another way to state it, like the property values, you don't usually include community sentiments. We're all very sentimental right now about this project, but that's not what they mean. They don't just kind of have a general idea of quality of life is not enough. Property value is usually not enough. Most economic impacts, both directions, good and bad, are not really the focus of CEQA.
Well, how about insurance?
Marilyn sat down, you did this, didn't you?
Yeah.
She sat down and turned the Davis PowerPoint, which is really good, into just a summary. And that's what I want to refer to right now. You probably got it there. If you get to, it has a summary list of many things that we've already talked about, but when you get to just the last 2 pages, it says, page 4, reviewing the EIR. There's good suggestions there about how to approach it. The page numbers are at the top of the page. And it starts with bullet points, 30 minutes, focus on tables, etc. Yeah, that one right there.